All good. Sorry to interrupt.
You've had a pretty remarkable career, as these things go, but it seems like you started, was music video really the start? Was that the
No, I was a cameraman first, and then I went on to do my first short film called Legacy, mm-hmm. and then I went into music videos.
So what got you to be a cameraman?
High school. I went to Highland Park High School for 11th grade and 12th grade, and there was a local access TV show that our high school was connected to, and the kids got a chance to produce, direct, and shoot this show. And so I started as a teenager, and then when I moved back to Los Angeles, when I was 18, I became a cameraman, and that led to film.
So were you like an obsessive cameraman? Were you very were you a very serious image guy?
Yes. Yeah, I was. But you know, that wasn't really exactly my start. My uncle was an actor, and he convinced me and my younger brother to go to his play. And so it started with interactions with this playhouse in Inglewood. Mm-hmm. And that's what sparked my interest in the entertainment business. And then when I moved to Illinois in high school, I just continued that interest at Highland Park, in Highland Park.
And so the short film ended up leading to music videos?
It led to music videos, which led to my introduction to Ice Cube, which led to Friday.
So this was kind of fated that you would end up being the guy who made this movie?
Call it what you like. It's definitely full circle. Definitely full circle and very personal to me.
So when you were in music videos, was making feature films your goal?
Oh yeah, no question about it. If you look at, you know, most of my music videos, they all were cinematic in their own ways. That was kind of the training ground for me. I would shoot 35 millimeter, use cranes, helicopter shots, action sequences, dialogue. So the artist, music artist, would get kind of a little short film, and I would get a chance to train technically in the art of, you know, creating scenes and narratives within music videos. So it was kind of, in a strange way, a portion of my film school, because I didn't go to film school.
And that was really, that was the heyday of music videos. That's when music videos were really, like, people waited for the premiere of Waterfalls.
Yeah, well, you can argue that that was, you know, one of the moment, big moments of music videos. You could argue that, you know, Michael Jackson and Thriller and all those moments were kind of big moments too in MTV.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was definitely a special time in music history when we were doing music videos, for
sure. But it wouldn't really be the way in anymore. I don't know that anybody can make that. There are a lot of directors who kind of came in through that universe.
Yeah, you know what? There were a few. I think Michael Bay did, and David Fincher,
Steve Carr,
Spike Jonze, yeah. Possibly. There are guys who definitely had a background, Hughes Brothers, in music videos that made the transition. But it's weird. People normally associate me with the music video guys because I experienced a lot of success. But I started with a camera, and then my short film. It was always a goal for me to make movies, always, since I was 16, when I did the television show. I just took that path to get there.
Yeah.
There are certain guys that are music video directors that say, hey, listen, if I can make a music video, I can make a movie.
Mm-hmm.
And it's two different skill sets.
Yeah. What's interesting, because I recently did a study of the last 15 years of people making their first studio movies, and the way, because there was always controversy about women making films or being having access to direct films. And
sure.
Videos. And it's every route is a little different, but there are, you know, five or six routes that people took that seem to pave the way.
Uh-huh.
That women are, I don't know, they're having a hard time. Did you feel as a black man that there was a boundary for you going into it?
Not really. I mean, I started my first film when I was 24 years old. I mean, you know, I don't have that story of, you know, the doors closing on me at every turn. I mean, I made Friday when I was 24, 25 years old. So in one sense, I was very lucky.
And were you just a very stable guy? Because it's a lot of success to suddenly have in your early 20s.
No, I was broke. I wasn't stable. I was broke when I started this journey. There, you know, I didn't have a lot of money, but that's part of what motivated me to become who I am today, because there was nothing to go back to. Mm. You know, grew up in the ghetto, we were on welfare, the whole thing.
But was it heady when it started to happen in a positive way?
Was it what?
Was it heady? Was it kind of intoxicating?
Of course. Well, heady, I don't know if I understand what that means.
Just that, intoxicating, I guess, is the, does it, you know, kind of get to your head when all of a sudden you're kind of the hot guy because you were...
No, not really, because I was pretty insecure about it. Mm-hmm. You know, I always felt like I was kind of lucky. You know, I never felt like I was talented. I always thought, you know, anyone given this opportunity would do the same thing, if not better. So, you know, Friday was kind of like luck of the draw. It just happened. We shot this little film on my block that I grew up on in 20 days, and it struck a chord and did well. And the next movie set it off, did well, but it wasn't like I knew it was going to happen. I, you know, you can't predict these things. You can't predict to this day what's going to happen. I think there's a little bit of kind of craziness and you know, maybe my approach, because I'm always focused kind of on what's next. Mm-hmm. I haven't spent a lot of time kind of looking back.
So what is your what's next? What is your kind of, do you want to do things differently each time? Do you want to,
I think that hurts me sometimes. You know, I love doing things differently each time. I've done it every time, something different, because I love the challenge. You know, this is, because I didn't go to college, this is like my learning grounds. You know, film is, you know, allow me to travel the world. You know, I've been meditating in the pyramids in Giza, I've traveled throughout the Amazon, I've kissed on top of the Eiffel Tower, I've, taken a drone to China and shot the Great Wall. You know, I've done photography in the base of Mount Fuji and a lot of different places. So I got a chance to kind of make up for the lack of education by directing movies. And so for me, it's a different experience. You know, when I do movies, I just soak it all up and I learn. So I'm always focusing on what can I learn next. And if I do the same movies over and over and over and over and over again, I feel it probably just wouldn't fit my personality. I feel I probably would feel a little stagnant, and probably would get a little stale for me.
So what's it like to have your like Italian Job and Man Apart in the same year?
Where it's you know what? It was interesting. It was rewarding in one sense. It was scary in the other. You know, I had better. You know, I wish Man Apart turned out a little better for, you know, than it did. And it was kind of on a shelf for a little bit. And then they decided to release it at the same time as the Italian Job. So that was kind of crazy. You're on the red carpet at the Chinese theater one day, and then 30 days later, you're on a red carpet at the Chinese theater for another movie. Mm-hmm. So it was a dynamic time, but very interesting. You know, each film had its own kind of share of lessons.
Do you linger in the success or failure of the films? I mean, is that part of your mindset, or do you kind of do the work and then let that happen?
I do the work and let it happen. This is probably, you know, this film hasn't even been released yet, and I'm thinking, I think I'm lingering a little bit in what we delivered because it's so personal to me. Mm-hmm. We're getting a great response. I hope it does well, but I'm really satisfied and happy with the way it turned out, and it's probably the first time I felt this way about a film I've directed.
So where did this start? When was the first conversation about doing this one?
2011. It was like 4 years ago. I've been involved with this project for 4 years. And it was, you know, a script sent to me. And I was nervous. I was like, oh no, the NWA story, how do you tell that and make it great? So it took me a couple weeks to actually read the script.
So was it sent to you through Cube or somebody specifically?
Well, from Cube and the producers, the whole thing, it was sent to me, but I kind of didn't know what to expect. Mm-hmm. It's such a big story, it's so many characters, it spans 10 years. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering, how do you fit that into one movie? You know, and it took me a while to read it, and when I did, I was pleasantly surprised. It still needed work, but I found a way in. I'm like, oh, okay. I could really dig in with this story, especially given my history with Los Angeles and with the group, and some of the social things I think they touched and that I'm passionate about. I felt like, man, this is a great opportunity. It's going to be hard, and it was, but definitely a good opportunity to step out in a different way as a filmmaker.
So what were the hardest parts? What was the hugest?
Well, one of the obvious things is just casting. Mm-hmm. How do you find NWA? Especially with Dre right here in popular culture and Q with his movies and stuff like that. People know what to expect or what they want out of these guys who are here in your consciousness, and it's so immediate. Finding these guys was the biggest challenge. You know, it took years. We scoured the earth, and we made, I think, the right choices.
So was there ever a question about Cube's son? Or?
Of course. It started with a question, and it was a question throughout the process of auditioning.
Did he just show up for an audition like a normal person?
He had to. He had to show up for the audition for a normal person and go to a callback like a normal person and do the chemistry test like a normal person. He wasn't given this role. It would have been highly irresponsible of me to just wake up one day and say, it's okay for you to have this role because your dad is producing the movie. Mm-hmm. And I don't think Ice Cube, I think he knows me well enough to know that my job is to protect the movie and to be responsible, and I will only make the right choice for a role so important, this important. You can only make the right choice because when the novelty of it's his son wears off, you still have to carry a movie. Mm-hmm. We have to believe you. And he did the work. 2 years, acting coaches, Aaron Spizer, Diane Castle. He went to New York and trained. And so in the process of auditioning, he had to compete all the way up until the last moment. And he did, and he showed up, and he delivered.
Well, the whole cast is, I mean, outside of Giamatti, is really mostly unknowns,
yeah,
relatively speaking. I mean, was that a decision you made early on? Was there ever a question of having, you know, actors who are better known play these characters, or was it always?
I refuse to make this movie with well-known actors, because, you know, between, you know, the people that you would consider and entertainers that are out there, it would feel like a gimmick. And I feel like the NWA story is way too important to rely on marketing gimmicks to sell it. You don't need to do that. Mm-hmm. But you have to convince the studio that you don't need to do that. And Donna Langley over at Universal, she championed this movie from the start. When I pitched her, you know, my version of the NWA story, she says, I like that, you go make your movie. And she let us make our movie.
Hmm. So casting was incredibly difficult.
Incredibly difficult, absolutely.
Was maneuvering through the real guys difficult? I mean,
sometimes.
The film is not always positive about them.
Sometimes. But in the way that, in a good way. You know, when you have such a controversial story with so many highs and so many lows, the lows were really low, the highs were really high, mm-hmm. Getting different stories on the same moment sometimes was kind of difficult to extract, you know, really kind of taking these guys through some of the more emotional moments, you know, mm-hmm. That was tough for them. You have two guys who have empires, you know. One guy is a tech guy who is associated with the biggest company on the planet Earth, a billionaire. So having to do 2 years of research and get all these personal stories about what happened when you were recording Boys in the Hood with Eazy-E, you know, and on the other end you're making an Apple deal, and you know, you have the number one movie in America and the star, and you're trying to extract all these stories about what happened when you left the group. Mm-hmm. Two moguls, you have to kind of focus and get these stories. Sometimes it was a challenge, but it wasn't because they didn't want to give me these details. It's just because, just by the sheer nature of being so busy, I had to maneuver through these schedules. And all in all, it was worth it. It was fun in a lot of ways. You know, I found myself in the Mediterranean on a yacht for 2 weeks with Dre, you know, extracting all these stories. That was fun. But it was a challenge as well.
So even though you started with a script, you're out there pulling as many little details as you can for yourself.
Well, the script was cool, but it wasn't perfect.
Yeah.
It was the bones of what it could be, mm-hmm. but the process of development and what you see on the screen was a lot of research. And even when we were shooting, I gave the actors the room to improvise and creatively collaborate and contribute to what makes this movie so I think authentic and real and raw. And it was just an ongoing process all the way through post. Mm-hmm. But the script wasn't perfect in any sense. It just represented what it could be.
So how much is left on the floor? How much movie is there that didn't make the movie?
the original cut was over 3 hours long. Mm. Yeah.
So I mean, is there a lot of did you slice it down from there, or were there big chunks that
absolutely
had to go,
there was no slicing? There was big chunks that had to go. to cut it down to 2 hours and something. It was tough. That was the second hardest part of making this movie. It was just trimming it down because there's so many great moments, and it was, you know, I think compelling moments that I could sit and watch a 3-hour version of this movie, but it's probably not good for business.
Well, it might be a good, DVD, a second DVD.
There you go. And there might be a director's cut. You never know.
I didn't find it long. I got to say, when I got up and I looked at my watch, and I was like, oh, that was longer than 2 hours.
Right. Well,
it didn't strike
good.
Me as having been a long experience at all.
Good. Well, it's a potent story. It's history. It's American history. And, you know, 100 years from now, when people watch this movie or look to see what was going on in America in the 80s and 90s, hopefully they reference this film. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a lot that went on that goes so far beyond NWA, so far beyond the music, you know, the social implications of what they had to deal with, the backdrop of and Compton and how it influenced and forged the group. There's a lot to this story. You couldn't just, you know, create some rap movie and, you know, it tell the full story.
Well, the three of them are such distinctively different characters, and it's really like three stories, three personal histories coming together.
Yeah.
As much as anything else.
It was tough, you know. There's five guys. We chose to focus as much as we could on the five guys, but obviously the three stories that stands out is Cube, Dre, and Easy, and the dynamic and how they came together and the brotherhood and the family aspect of it, and then how, you know, money and outside influences divided and conquered these guys, and the impact.
And the women are significant in this movie. It's not like they're secondary. They have a big impact.
They are, and they still have impact to this day. You know, Cube has been married for over 20 years. Dre's been married for 20 years, and so, you know, you think you know NWA, but you don't. Mm-hmm. And that's part of, I think, the charm of this movie, because you get a chance to experience NWA through a different lens and go beyond what you can Google, go beyond what you can get on Wikipedia. And, you know, that's a testament to what they, you know, they offered, you know, in their stories.
How fun was it to go back into the music?
It was incredibly fun. You know, it was a soundtrack to my youth. Mm-hmm. I remember when I heard Boys in the Hood. I was on 126th Street in Normandy, and I was wondering, I was just thinking, damn, this is the soundtrack to my life. Like, how do they know? I was shocked at the honesty and at the content, and it was entertaining, it was funny, it was real. And I enjoyed it. I'm a big NWA fan.
And you're like 10 years younger than them, pretty much, right?
No, I'm the same age as Cube. Thanks for asking, by the way. Make me old. Okay.
No, you look young.
No, thank you. No, I'm the same age. I was born in 1969.
Huh. Mm-hmm. So what is it like to drag Giamatti into this
That's fantastic. Are you kidding me? That's Paul Giamatti. He's like, he's going to go down in history as one of our great actors. And this is not the first time I work with him. I worked with him on The Negotiator, with Sam Jackson and Kevin Spacey. He played Rudy. And he was great then. He's great now. There are times when I'm directing Paul and I forget to say cut because I'm just lost in his performance. All the choices he makes and his eyes are so expressive. You're just kind of like, oh, okay, cut, all right, cut, sorry, you know, and then you get, and you get lost in it. And it was he anchored the movie in a sense because he had the most experience. And I think when he showed up, a lot of the guys kind of gravitated, you know, to him and learned from him.
So it was a pretty low key performance for him most of the way.
For the most part, you know, it was good though. I loved it.
Oh, he's great. And the guy you found for Shug is pretty amazing.
Yeah, Mark. Yeah, he was awesome. You know, I think he's an MMA fighter, actually. Oh. Stuntman. His background isn't in acting. Huh. Not in like Shay. He didn't do a ton of acting before this.
Hmm. Yeah. So are you proud of that, the fact that you got this kind of cast together and got these performances out of relative novices?
Absolutely. You know, anytime you can, you make a choice and they exceed your expectations, it feels good. It feels great. These guys are amazing. Like they to me deliver world-class performances. Jason Mitchell, a guy from New Orleans without, you know, much experience at all, carries the movie, you know. So does Shay, with no experience whatsoever. Corey Hawkins, who he comes from Broadway and Juilliard, you know, with without a ton of, you know, experience playing street guys, you know, he delivers as well. So I'm extremely happy with their performances.
So when did you show it to the guys?
I showed it to them when we were halfway through post production, and they freaked out. You know,
in a good way, I guess.
You know, they freaked out in a good way, absolutely. They didn't know what I was going through. There was a method to my madness, and I put them through it. And there was a brotherhood that we all kind of enjoyed through the process, but it was hard as well for them. And they didn't know what we were doing. Mm-hmm. And when I showed them the movie, they flipped out.
And now I'm not going to make sure which I know which guys we're talking about. We're talking about the actors, or we're talking about...
The actors. Cube and Dre. I showed them early in the process. You know, I showed them early in the process during my director's cut, the long version of it, and they were pleasantly surprised. You know,
is Cube, it nerve-wracking to show it to them?
It's always nerve-wracking to show the first cut of any movie. You know, you still haven't had the chance to refine the cut, but. You know, I was confident that it was good, but it definitely needed work. And I looked forward to their input as well, because these guys are artists as well, and they're tuned into that creative frequency. I can't articulate what it is, but you know, artists know. It's like when you got it, you got it, and when you know it, you know it. So I look forward to their input as well during that process.
But is there any extra pressure in terms of it being their story?
Of course, the pressure was there from the start, and through the shooting and through post-production. And we had, you know, spirited conversations about a lot of things, but that's part of what made it great.
And do they concede to you when push comes to shove?
They always said that at the end of the day, it's your final decision. But again, we had some great moments and going back and forth. But that's, again, what made it great. No, you know, no one's afraid to speak their mind. Mm-hmm. And it kind of taps into the whole NWA philosophy. It is what it is, you know, whether you like it or not. And since we have a relationship that goes well beyond the process of making this movie, we could be honest with each other.
Mm-hmm. And that's part of the story. I mean, all of this... You know, in some ways, the story of this movie is a microcosm of their story.
It is.
Amazingly enough.
That's absolutely true. And that's the reason why it's, I believe, arguably my most important film. Because out of it, I believe I'm a better filmmaker, a better storyteller. And the process, although, you know, challenging at times, I think, you know, I'm going to bring a lot to whatever I do next because of it.
So do you feel like it was, I mean, what is it quote unquote personal?
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah.
For you, quote unquote, quote unquote,
however you want to frame it, it is definitely more the most personal work to date. No question about it. You know, I grew up in Los Angeles at the time. I experienced a lot of what they wrote about, you know, or witnessed it. Mm-hmm. And so it's really close to me. You know, it goes beyond the music videos I directed for them and even my first movie. You know, they experienced a lot of stuff that I experienced. And so a lot of my heart is in this movie, and I think you feel it.
And part of the movie is that the world changes when you have the kind of success that they had, that the different kinds of people in the world and all that. Have you found that to be the case for yourself, or have you tried to find ways of staying grounded and not getting kind of sucked into the Hollywood?
I've been doing this for over 20 years, man. I can't, you know, there's not a lot that impresses me. You know, I really focus on what can I learn. You know, you hopefully through, you know, any experience you have, you experience some challenges and then you evolve. The glitz and the glamour, it doesn't impress me. You know, I've been around it for too long. I'm not looking for validation or lost validation through, you know, doing work in Hollywood. I'm appreciative, and there is some gratification from people appreciating my work, but at the same time, our job is done. Whatever this movie does at the box office, however it's received by the critics, it doesn't matter. You know, we told our story.
Will you read every review, or will you read none of the reviews?
Hell no, I'm not going to read all these reviews, because you're bound to have haters. You're bound to have people who are not going to understand it, and you're going to have some people who genuinely just didn't get it. I didn't make this for critics, you know. I made it for us, and Donna Langley was gracious enough to allow us to do that. And whatever happens, happens after this.
So if you're 95% on Rotten Tomatoes, would that make you feel better about critics?
I don't have a problem with critics. I'm just saying I didn't make it for critics.
Right.
And, you know, if I get a 95% or 90 or 80, great. Of course it's going to feel good that people got it, but not because, I'm not going to feel good because I feel more important. I'm going to feel good because I tapped into something deep in my heart, and I expressed myself creatively in ways I've never done it before. And if they tapped into that, then they got it. That makes me happy. Like, okay, you get it. But I'm not going to feel more important because it does anything at a box office, or because someone feels that I'm more of a filmmaker than I was before. I'm not looking for that validation.
And are you over the I didn't go to film school sense that you're not completely in control of your craft, or you now feel like, is there a point in your career, whether it's this film or three films ago or whatever, where you finally felt like, okay, now I'm a professional director, this is my job, I know what I'm doing?
You're asking very good questions. Thank you about that. Seriously, thank you for that. I feel like this is one of my most complete films. You know, I don't think you ever feel like you've arrived, but I'm very satisfied with the way this turned out. And again, like I said, whatever happens, happens.
But you probably can always carry that chip a little bit.
What chip?
Is what I'm hearing, that you're never quite feeling like you're the best that you can be, that there's always another step to take.
Best you can be is relative. You know, I tell different stories. You know, I've made comedies, I've made thrillers, I've made action films. So to say that's the best I can be is relative to what I'm doing. I think that, you know, this is my first biopic. I might make another one, you know, I might not, but I definitely feel like I've expressed myself creatively more in this film than any other film. The films that led up to this have been cool, they've been entertaining, but I also feel like they're kind of like boot camp, you know, and I guess you say that for every film. It's like, oh, all the films that led up to this point were boot camp. Mm-hmm. But maybe that's true of every film, but I think that in terms of being at the helm and really giving a lot of who you are. Mm-hmm. This is the project I've done the most of that, especially given my background.
Yeah. No, it's interesting because I talk to directors all the time, and it's always that thing of, you know, the people who have great craftsman skills, and then the artistic side, and you know how that balances out, and how somebody becomes, you know, a top level craftsman, but then they have to express the art more, and their people come in are really artists and have to learn how to do the craft, and it's always a fascinating challenge for directors.
Well, it's a combination of both with this one.
Yeah.
Definitely. I feel like artistically I've stepped out a little bit. I've been lucky enough to work with a DP who understood that. Matty Libertique, he's a genius. And, you know, I can't take all the credit for this movie creatively. I mean, I wish I woke up and said, okay, this is what it's going to be. Yeah. I definitely had a clear sense of what I wanted, but he added a lot to this process. So did Shane Valentino, my production designer. And all my whole crew, you know, Kelly, Lisa Satriano, my first AD, everybody really contributed a lot to make this what it is. And I don't want it to sound like an acceptance speech for an award, but I really truly feel that way. So I think it's probably one of my more artistic films. I think that in terms of craft, it's up there as well. So, you know, I think I'm closest I've ever been mm-hmm. to feeling that I've made something that feels, if you can describe it, as complete.
Yeah. It's hard to make something that could be episodic breathe. And I think it's the great thing about this movie is that it really feels like it's living.
Thank you.
When you watch it, which is...
I appreciate that. It started off episodic. Yeah. The original draft was...
It was a lot of story to get in.
It was a lot of story to get in, you know, and it took, you know, meeting with the principals and, you know, Scott Bernstein, who was an executive at the time, who turned producer, was really helpful in that process of, you know, developing and shaping the structure, and then really creating a narrative that didn't feel episodic. We worked with John Herman and Andrea Berloff and different writers to really kind of mold it into what it is, and it was hard, but at the end of the day, worth it.
Excellent. Thank you so much.
Thank you, brother.
Thanks.